It's 1969, not
Yeah, I think it's the
okay.
year.
Okay.
69. This
Okay.
isn't 420XXX on his username.
Yeah, he doesn't have like a Mountain Dew and Doritos profile picture
Yeah,
on
I think
Discord or
this
something.
more this may be an ignorant boomer rather than nice.
Okay, gotcha. He's not just like
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and Matt Cavender.
Welcome to episode 53 of season 5 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide and recorded from the state of hockey. I'm Tim Brown, your host, and I'm joined this week by Rob Gilreath.
Hey, guys.
And Matt Cavender.
You already know who it is.
I might as well do this right on the podcast. We're throwing Dustin under the bus because we're switching from Slack to Discord, and he refuses to join us, so he was not aware that we are recording tonight. So that's where he is. I don't even know if he listens to this, so he might never hear this. So with Michigan Tech season over now and the Providence Regional behind us, we reached out to Mike McMahon, who covered the regional for College Hockey News and runs a Substack called College Hockey Insider. Thanks for joining us, Mike.
Yeah, thanks for having me back.
Yeah. This week we'll talk about Michigan Tech, BC, the Providence Regional, the NCAA Tournament. I'm sure we'll talk about the Misfits fundraiser and their lovely trek to Providence and back. And then we'll talk about the transfer portal. And I guess maybe we should have that Stonehill conversation on the podcast, since Matt's so enamored with Stonehill. So
fascinated by them.
Anything else you guys want to talk about?
Nope. That sounds good.
Now let's put a bow on the season.
All right. We'll be right back with Mike McMahon after a little thank you notes and a brief note from our sponsor.
Hey there. Did you know Kroger always gives you savings and rewards on top of our lower than low prices? And when you download the Kroger app, you'll enjoy over $500 in savings every week with digital coupons. And don't forget fuel points to help you save up to $1 per gallon at the pump. Want to save even more? With a Boost membership, you'll get double fuel points and free delivery. So shop and save big at Kroger today. Kroger, fresh for everyone. Savings may vary by state. Restrictions apply. See site for details.
We fund everything a Tech Hockey Guide from listeners like you. You can show your support by becoming a patron at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Whether you're interested in question priority, access to patron-only Zoom chats with coaches and players, in-stat deep dives, extended versions of the podcast, unedited video or audio, early access, or commercial-free listening, there's a level for you. We also now have 15% discounts off annual memberships with tiers ranging from $2 to $50 per month. Again, sign up at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. Are you in the market for insurance? Have your rates for home, auto, boat, or more been increasing way beyond inflation? If so, maybe it's time you spoke with Aaron Pietola and the team at Arcadia Insurance Group, serving Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and more. Who better to serve you than a former Michigan Tech player? For more information, call 866-511-1069 or go to arcadiaagency.com. Welcome back. Well, Matt, you've been dying to ask Mike about Stonehill, so why don't you start there?
I have been so fascinated with Stonehill and just the way they are and the way they operate and just how a team could kind of go into D1 hockey and just appear so directionless and not really have like a way forward. And Mike, as I understand it, you have a pretty decent relationship with the AD at Stonehill and have a pretty good breakdown as to what's going on there. So would you mind speaking a little bit on that? Because this is my special interest this season.
Sure. I'll give you the Reader's Digest version. So they were a D2 school that brought all their programs to D1 2 years ago to join the Northeast Conference. Mainly as those moves are made, they're mainly made for basketball. Like, they have access to basketball money now. NEC has an auto bid. So they make this move for basketball. All of their other programs end up going D1 in the process, and it's not a big deal, right? Because there isn't a big difference between D2 baseball and lower level D1 baseball. It's not much of a difference, just who you're playing. So at that point, though, they needed to kind of up their investment, I think, in those other sports. So I'll use baseball as an example. At the D2 level, they probably had a full-time head coach and a part-time assistant coach, and that was it. Well, even at the lower level, D1 level, you're going to need a full-time head coach and probably a one or two full-time assistants, let's say. So you're upping your staffing for all these other sports. And hockey, which was D2, but played down into D3 because they were allowed to, now is kind of floating in this middle ground. I think the idea was, look, we're either going to get rid of hockey or we're going to move forward with it. And at the time, the president of the school said, we're in New England, how can we not have hockey? So they decided to keep hockey, but a lot of their resources for those first couple of years had to be put towards the other programs at the school because they needed to hire more baseball coaches. They needed to hire more basketball coaches, administrators for those sports. So a lot of attention and a lot of resources were put towards getting everybody else that was in a conference already kind of up and running. And now that's all taken care of. It takes a little bit, but now that's all taken care of. So now they're starting to focus more on hockey. Now it's time for them to get hockey going, as it was described to me. So I think that's why they went out today and hired David Berard, who's got a background as a Division I head coach in Atlantic Hockey, which is where they would like to get to. So it makes sense. He's got history in that league. So I think this is kind of the first steps forward they're taking from a hockey standpoint. And again, like, they want to get into Atlantic Hockey. They don't have any aspirations of getting in Hockey East. They are trying to build a facility on campus. I think that's going to happen. I was told today, like, the plan is they're going to be off campus for two more years and then their facility's ready and they'll be on campus. And they hope at that point that they're in a conference. I think that may be discussed in Naples this year. So things are starting to move forward from a hockey standpoint. I think when they first moved up, they were in a little bit of a holding pattern where the league, like, let's say Atlantic Hockey, that's who they're talking to. I mean, Atlantic Hockey may say to them, hey, we want to see you invest a little more in hockey, and Stonehill saying, well, we can't invest more in hockey until we're in a league. So they were kind of in a holding pattern where they're both, you know, staring at each other going, well, what do we do now? Now it feels like with their other sports settled, they're able to start to push hockey forward a little bit. Even if they get into Atlantic Hockey, I don't think they'll ever even be a top program in Atlantic Hockey the way that RIT has been or AIC has been. But I think that they can be respectable in Atlantic Hockey because there's a lot of hockey players in New England, and they can offer something. Like, as a small private school, if you don't want to go to a big camp, there's a small campus, it's all in one spot. There's some kids that don't want to go to a bigger school, and it's a good academic school. So, like, that might be a good fit. I think from Berard's standpoint right now, there's going to be like 400 kids in the portal this year. So even if, and look, Stonehill had a lot of guys go in, but you can go in and if they're going to put the scholarships together, put together a halfway decent Atlantic Hockey roster out of guys in the portal that are going to be low on options. So, you know, I think that they're going to start, it's going to still be a slow process, but I think they're starting to take some steps forward.
That's really good for me to hear, because I think the biggest thing that I was, you know, concerned about is I just didn't think it was fair to anybody involved to like send out, you know, let's face it, a non-competitive squad to really go out there and get killed every night. I didn't think it was really fair to the kids on that team. I didn't really think it was fair to a lot of Division I hockey to have them factored into the pairwise. I didn't think it was fair to a lot of opponents. I just, you know, their existence and their appearance to me as, you know, a hockey primary fan is like kind of being directionless. Hearing that they are getting that infrastructure going and that they've hired a coach that has like legitimate D1 experience is that's really good for me to hear. I'm happy that there's going to be like there is a future and there is a plan there, even if it kind of was hobbling along to get there.
Yeah. And look, I share that frustration too. I was critical of them when they first did this, because it's like, especially last year, I'm like, what are you doing? You know, you played five Division I games, you're losing a D3 program. It's like, what are you doing? And then the schedule they put together this year, again, I was like, what are you doing? Like, unless the idea was just, look, Michigan's going to pay us, so we're going to go get, you know, killed by Michigan. Okay, and we're going to collect our check
and home. Now we can afford to hire another coach next year.
I don't know if that was the idea. I didn't ask that question specifically, but at least, okay, maybe that's a reason for it. Because you look at the schedule they put together this year, and some of those games, you're like, man, you know, you're better off having 27 games instead of 34 and not subjecting yourself to some of that stuff.
Yeah. So is what's going on with Stonehill the reason that like the Northeast 10 conference exists as it is, as like a D2 conference, even though that's like the only D2 in the country?
Yeah, those schools all kind of got stuck. And I don't really know the whole history on it, but they could all play up as D1s if they wanted to, you know? Yep. So
basically be like the lowest conference in D1 and just take their auto bid and do what they want, right?
Yeah. I don't know why they haven't done that, to be honest with you. Like, I guess I will be upfront. I don't follow women's hockey all that closely, but I do have a loose understanding of some of it. And I know that there's a similar league. I think it's called like the New England Women's Hockey Association, I think.
Always know it as New Ha, but yeah.
Yeah. So, which is kind of that. Like, it was kind of a bunch of smaller schools, in which Stonehill is in, ironically enough, that created a D1 conference, and they have an auto bid, and they don't typically do well against the other, you know, more power conferences, whatever you're going to call them. But I don't. Because you can make your own rules from a league standpoint. Like, if the Northeast 10 decided that, if all those schools decided we're going to play up as Division Ones and we're only going to give 2 scholarships apiece, okay. Like, you can do that. Atlantic Hockey wasn't giving 18 scholarships for a long time. They are now, yep. But they weren't for a while. So I don't know why they haven't decided to do that, because to me, I think that I don't really think it costs them any, like, it's not costing them any more money.
No, I don't. You know? I get it from the perspective of, like, they're just fine playing each other. And maybe they don't want to do what Stonehill did last year, but they don't want to invest more than Stonehill did last year. And that's kind of where they're at. Yep. But at least they'd get to go up and play each other and then maybe play like 4 games against Atlantic Hockey and a couple games against St. Lawrence and Clarkson or something. Like, they don't have to go play BC and BU and Michigan, right?
And now you also have access to be like, hey, you know what? To make our budget work, North Dakota is going to pay us $50,000 to kick the crap out of us this weekend. Well, okay. Well, you know, at least our kids will get to, you know, our guys will get to, it'll be a good trip. Like, we'll get to go out there and see a pretty cool arena and see the facility, and we're going to take our check and go home, and it's going to pay for one of our assistant coaches this year. Like, you have the opportunity to do stuff like that, where as D2 in the Northeast 10, you don't have the opportunity to do.
Yeah. See, I think what it comes down to is, like, investing in the resources to really bring that program up. Because what we have to remember is that in that Northeast 10 or whatever it was, Stonehill was dominating that. And if that's the kind of school that's dominating that conference and they struggle to win against D3 opponents, it kind of almost makes you feel like the D2 in hockey, just in the way that it ends up happening, is kind of at an equal or maybe even slightly lower level than, like, D3, at least the upper level D3 program.
I think it's lower.
So yeah, I would argue that as well, especially if Stonehill is your powerhouse in like Northeast 10 school or whatever. Yeah. But so
and all those
I
schools
think
are around here. Like, obviously I'm outside of Boston. They're all local to New England, and they struggle to get kids because it's almost like being an independent where you're D2, but there's nothing really other than your like league championship. There's nothing at the end of the year. You can't play in the D3 tournament even if you go undefeated, because you're not a D3, you're a D2. Whereas, okay, so if I'm a kid, I'm going to go to Stonehill or Southern New Hampshire and play D2, or am I going to go to, I don't know, Curry College, which is like a similar school, but they're D3, and this year they were one of the best D3 teams in the country. Like, and I can try to win a national title. Or can I go to Endicott College, which is the same thing, small private D3 school, which is generally one of the top D3 schools around. You're going to go the D3. Most players around here go the D3 route before they go the D2 route, because there's a national championship at the end of it that you can.
Yeah, well, exactly.
And are those D2 schools even offering that many scholarships? I don't even know what the limit is for a D2 school anyway. Like,
yeah, I know they're allowed even, to offer, but yeah, I don't
they
think
are.
They wouldn't do.
Yeah. Cause I don't even know what, like, because the NCAA doesn't even sponsor it. I don't even know if they set a limit. Like,
they might not. Yeah. They're kind of operating on their own island.
Yeah. No, that's interesting. Cause I've always kind of wondered why they just sit there in that, like, I don't know. They're in kind of purgatory, like you said, cause they don't get to play for a national championship at all. And it's weird, weird spot to be in. I suppose we should ask our questions. Rob, did you figure out one from the email I forwarded you?
I got a couple out of that. There's no way to get that down to just one question.
Yeah, no, I figured as much.
I broke it into several sections, chapters, if you will, of the submittance. This could be an article, a small form article on its own, one of the submissions we got. Kind of the first thing he's asking about is kind of your perspective, being from an Eastern perspective. What are your thoughts are just on the CCHA in general, comparing it to like Atlantic Hockey or ECAC? Where do you think it fits in the college hockey landscape?
So this year in particular, I think all those leagues are pretty similar. You know, everyone kind of, there's peaks and valleys. Everybody kind of has some ups and some downs. I know from talking to CCHA coaches, one of the things that they're struggling with, which I don't think the Eastern schools are struggling with as much, is battling with the Big Ten for players. You know, I've talked to the guys like at Bowling Green who were like, every player we talk to that's moderately local wants to go to Ohio State. All of them. They all want to go to the Big Ten. So that's something that I think they're becoming accustomed to, and they're figuring out ways around it. I think that's why when you had these reports out there earlier in the year that with the talk of the CHL players and whether or not they'll be eligible, and the talk was kind of that, you know, the CCHA for the most part was on board. I think that's smart because they look at it as, here's an opportunity for us to go get some older, more skilled players that aren't necessarily looking at things going, oh, I want to go play in the Big Ten, or I'm not going to go anywhere else. Yeah. So I think that they're smart in the way that they're approaching it. I think that it's also, there's going to be some ups and downs overall. But I mean, the top of the CCHA should still be as good as the top of the ECAC. And right now, I mean, lately the top of the ECAC has really only been two schools, you know, and if you kind of separate Quinnipiac out from there, it's, I think the top of the CCHA can be as competitive as the top of the ECAC. They're all very similar. And then even, you know, within some of the other Eastern leagues, like I look at Hockey East, the top of Hockey East is on a much different plane than the rest of Hockey East. So like that middle, from the middle of Hockey East down, is very similar to the top of the CCHA or the top to middle of the ECAC. Like, it's kind of funny how everyone kind of gets tiered and slotted together. I look at non-conference schedule or non-conference records to kind of weight conferences every year, but that can be misleading too sometimes, because it all depends on who you play. But yeah, that's where I think they're similar to.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to ding the CCHA for their record against Atlantic Hockey when it was just Fair State and Bowling Green and I forget who else that actually played them, right? Like, it's
exactly
like you didn't play Minnesota State, Tech, and Northern, and Bemidji didn't play those teams, and I think that's one of the biggest struggles the CCHA has. Is 80% of their non-conferences against NCHC and Big Ten, which are two of the best conferences in the country, clearly.
Yeah, that makes it an uphill climb. You know, it's the same thing with Atlantic Hockey. A lot of theirs are against Hockey East, and ECAC too. But, you know, a lot of those schools at the beginning of the year are playing Hockey East schools, and some of them are playing the top of Hockey East, and it doesn't usually go well. But it's, I think we're getting to a point where you're going to have, I hate to put it this way because it's kind of depressing to think about, but like, you're going to have your teams at the top of the big, you're going to have the Big Ten, because they're all seven of those could be involved in this. The top of the NCHC, the top of Hockey East, and then maybe throw in Quinnipiac and Cornell. And after that, everybody else is kind of the same.
Yep.
You know, because, and it seems that way now. I mean, when you look at the portal, look at where these guys are going to go. They're going to Denver, North Dakota. They're going to any Big Ten school. They're going to BCBU. Or Quinnipiac. Like, that's where the best players are generally going.
And then you just have to be lucky, or not lucky, but you have to be like quick to react when an opportunity like Isaac Gordon pops up, where he had to decommit because they picked up, was it a kid out of the portal or was it a kid from Europe? I forget how that worked out, but like, you have to be like you have to pounce on the kids that get left out by Wisconsin and Michigan and Michigan State when they get these new kids in, right? Because they also have the ability to move on now. Like, some of Michigan Tech's best players ever have been like, was it, I forget who it was now. It was Bretzman and Bliss that were both decommitments from Wisconsin when Granato came in.
Yeah.
Like, so it's like, you have to, like, that's, and honestly, like, as much as we complain about the portal as Tech fans, like, the portal's been pretty good to us. I think it's a dream.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah. And I do see that. I mean, I'm one of the ones that's a big negative proponent in terms of us about it. I don't care for it. I mean, I fully can appreciate, however, that we have gained a few really good players through it. That's definitely been a thing that we've done, I think, well to get some fill in there.
I've said this to a couple of people now. It's like those bigger schools, you know, I'll use BC as an example. They recruit 12 guys that are good enough to be top six forwards. There's only six spots.
Yep.
So when six of those guys aren't on the power play and they get pissed, they're going into the portal and another team, they're going to go somewhere. Generally speaking, that second chance is they're going to go to a school where they feel like they can get an opportunity. You know, like a Harris, I'll use like a Harrison Roy as a big example. Goes to BC for a year. I'm on the fourth line. I'm not in the power play. Ends up going to Lake State and having a pretty nice career for himself. You know, like that type of player is still going to exist every year because those schools aren't generally recruiting third and fourth line guys. They have guys that end up there, but they're recruiting a bunch of guys that could be in anybody else's top six. And there's like, the beauty of that is there's only six spots. Like no matter how you try to play with it, there's only six of them. So
yeah, you're going to get the chip on their shoulder guys that go somewhere because they didn't get that top six spot they thought they deserved when they end up at a Big Ten school.
And then we'll be the
like Jack Works. Like, how happy are we to have him? Because he left Denver after a freshman year where he barely played, right? Like,
and that door will swing the other way too, where a guy will go to Michigan Tech, you know, as a freshman and explode. And then, you know, he's a Denver sophomore year. Like, that'll too.
Carson Bantle for you. He went to Wisconsin after his freshman
year. Well, that's not, he didn't.
That's more of a dream. That's a dream team possibility. Like, kid gets his, you know, I grew up watching this team and gets an opportunity to go. You can't hold that against him.
Not at all, but still, it happened.
Yep. It happened.
And that's going to happen, I think. You know, absolutely. I mean, I think you're going to see that from some guys. Like
Well, Joey Larson did that last year.
100%, right? Yeah,
100%.
Yep. And there'll be more this year. I think some that aren't even in yet, where you'll be like, okay, yeah, it was a big freshman year, and now he's going to go to North Dakota.
we only have, what, 43 more days of waiting to see if anybody we don't want in the portal goes in the portal?
Yeah, roughly. I think it's May 14th. So yeah, roughly.
It's 45 days from Sunday, right?
The day before fishing season. Easy enough to remember.
Yeah. next question, Rob.
Yeah, second question, similar on the league kind of comparison as well, but more on the reffing side of things. One of the comments was that the penalty that Chase got, CCHA refs may not have even called it, right? But in Hockey East, where it's a little more tightly called, a little less physical, you get that penalty. Now, you know, maybe we don't score a shorty if we don't have a shorty to be on, right? But
well, first thing I want to say about that one is they were NCHC refs, right?
I don't know.
Even though we were playing out east, but I'm pretty sure that game was NCHC refs.
Yeah, it wouldn't have been Hockey East or CCHA because
it could have been ECAC, but I thought it was.
I think it was NCHC. Right? Yeah.
We got the refs we wanted, Rob.
I didn't ask. I'm asking the listener question. This isn't my question.
And I would have replied with that to him, but we saved it for the show. So yeah.
I didn't think there was anything really wrong with the way the reffing went out there. I thought it was pretty well called, to be honest. And each team had their 5-minute major, whether the Tech one was, you know, a five or not. I don't think it impacted the game a bit, but we'd already gone downhill by that point. I thought we were already clearly losing. It was just by how much, and that helped.
Yeah. So your thoughts on reffing?
But yeah, his question is basically along the lines of, you know, do you think there's that big of a difference between Eastern and Western reffing at this point, or have we moved past that yet?
I think a little bit, yeah. I mean, from what I've seen, I think hockey's officials call everything. because I mean, I watch a lot of that, and it's like, oh my God, like really? It's just like you can't go 5 minutes without there being a penalty called. That's why I've for a while now have said that instead of the leagues having a coordinator of officials, there should be a national coordinator of officials with a national protocols or standard for what their points of emphasis are and things of that nature, instead of every league saying different things to their officials. Because you've also, at least out east too, you've got officials that cross over from league to league. There's guys that do Atlantic Hockey and Hockey East.
That's what's happening out west now too. The three leagues are sharing out west now.
Well. So like, if we're
the three
doing
coordinators
that
are also working together, I think better than maybe out east.
What, like, that's if we're sharing officials already, like, just can we just do a national thing? What doesn't seem like it'd be that hard to me. And then all these guys can just bounce around, and you don't, it'll probably prevent you from seeing the same people over and over again too, which may be a help. My biggest frustration overall with officials is just when the standard changes from earlier in the game to later in the game or whatnot.
Sure.
Like, or even game to game in some cases, depending upon who you have. Like, you know, I thought that the standard changed in the Denver Cornell game on Saturday night. Like, it, there was a penalty called in the third period where I was like, I don't think that's going to be called. That wasn't called earlier in the game. I watched that same play happen earlier in the game and it wasn't called. So like, that's where it gets frustrating. I think you solve a lot of the issues in terms of what's a point of emphasis league to league if we just had the officials coordinated on a national basis. It just seems like that makes too much sense.
Yeah, and I think part of the problem is you'll never get like the NCHC or Big Ten to want to give up that control. But at the same time, I do think there can be a lot more done that goes beyond what Marco Hunt's already done this year in trying to get, like, it really helps because he knows the head of officials at the NCHC and the head of officials at the Big Ten, because they were all like WCHA guys back in the day. So it helps that they have a connection where it's easy for them to share and talk and all that stuff. And Marco talks a lot about how, you know, anytime they have those big calls, like the kick goal for Tech, like he sends that around and asks all the head of officials, like, what would you have called to try and get a feel for, like, are we on the right page with everybody else kind of thing? And so I think that's happening more now than it has, but it still hasn't quite trickled down to all the refs. But I do think it's headed in the right direction. I know out west it seems way better than it has been, as much as Jay-Z hates it.
Jay-Z, I don't know if you saw earlier today, may have mentioned that listening to Marco's podcast may have changed some of his opinions on reffing.
Yeah.
So maybe
and I don't know if you listened to it, Mike, but one of the things that I think is worth reiterating here that I had never heard before at the college level was that, like, it has always felt like replay has been used to, like, relitigate the play in the moment, whereas Marco basically made it clear that, like, replay is supposed to only overturn clear and obvious. So if the ref thought he saw one thing and watches the replay and it's inconclusive, he's not supposed to change the call, even if the replay looks like he might have been wrong. If he's not 99% sure he was wrong, it's not supposed to change. And I think that's something that's been missing in the discourse, whether it's the announcers or fans, period, that, like, we don't quite get how important the call on the ice is in the result of the replay, because it's not talked that way like it is in the NFL. The NFL makes it clear of, like, it needs to be incontrovertible evidence to overturn it. And we don't have that language the way the announcers talk about it in college hockey.
No. And there was a play earlier in the year. I think it was in February. I forget. I think it was UMass UNH game, maybe. There was a play in overtime where I think the puck probably crossed the line and it should have resulted in a UMass goal, is what I think it was. Or no, it was a glove save. It was a glove save. UNH goalie made a glove save. And I think the puck probably, like, my interpretation when I saw it, and a lot of UMass fans got mad at me about this, was I think the puck probably crossed the line before he caught it. But every angle I saw, you can't see the puck cross the line.
Because the glove's in the way, right?
That's why they had to call it no goal. And people were like, well, common sense. I'm like, it was no goal on the ice. There was no goal called on the ice. And you can't see the puck cross the line. It just, like you said, it was never properly explained.
Kind of like that, St. Louis, was that I don't even know who scored that goal, because I don't know what game that was, but where that puck against St. Louis bounces, like, up over the line and it's like a foot or two off the ice. And it clearly goes in if you do the geometry of, like, the angle of the camera is not straight over the line. So it probably crossed, but you never see it incontrovertibly beyond the line. So it is not a goal. Yeah.
Yeah. So a lot of people mad at me, where I was like, I agree with you that I think it went in. However, you don't see it go in. That's why in the call on the ice was no goal. That's why it was no goal.
It's hard. And when you're invested in one of the teams, it makes it even harder to not just feel like the refs are out to screw you.
100%. I get that. Yeah.
And it's really easy to not look at the refs as people and not look at them like the thing that I've always focused on is like, look at how many mistakes, like Michigan Tech makes a mistake on the first shift and gives up a goal. BC makes a mistake on the power play and gives up a goal. Well, look at all those mistakes that were made in that game. And then if the ref makes one, we want to hang him up. Like, and he's not allowed to make one, right? Like, they're going to make mistakes too. And hopefully they balance out over the course of a season, and they should, right? Like, and I think that was, and based on the way the season went for Michigan Tech, the game against Minnesota State was just kind of like that balancing out from all the calls we feel like we didn't work out for us throughout the year. Cause it like, they've had a hard time. Like, my problem with Michigan Tech has always been, it feels like they have to work twice as hard as everybody else to actually put the puck at the net. And it was nice to finally get some bounces, because I think there's only been two games all year where it felt like the bounces went our way and we didn't have to work our butts off to get every goal we got. So, all right, what's the next one, Rob?
The rest are more tech focused, so I think we can save them for later. I don't think they're they're not,
or
more
maybe the next episode.
Next episode would be good. Yeah.
So then
they're more player composition type stuff for the team.
Since we talked about the portal on Discord, we got two questions kind of about that. Husky Walk On 69 wants to know, what effect has NIL payments had on player decisions in the portal from a hockey perspective?
Can we pause real quick? We really just made this man listen to Husky Walk On 69, and then he had to sit there and listen to the question thereafter and try to formulate a response. I don't think that's fair to our guest at all.
There is an apostrophe in there, so I assume he's like, it's not it's 1969.
I think it's the year.
69. Okay.
This isn't 420XXX on his username.
Yeah, he doesn't have like a Mountain Dew and Doritos profile picture on on Discord.
I think this
or something.
This may be an ignorant boomer rather than nice.
Okay, gotcha. He's not just like hitting the air horn when he's hearing his question on the podcast. All right.
Yeah.
How much is NIL playing in portal decisions?
Yeah.
I think it for the top players, it's playing a big role. And the ones, the people you hear that are saying it doesn't, is from a coaching standpoint, it's because those are the ones that are offering it the most. I got a kick out of this last year. I was doing a story at the Frozen Four about NIL, and it felt like the only guy who was honest was Rand Pecknold, where he was like, yeah, it's here. And everybody's using it, like the bigger schools are. And the more you do, the better off you're going to be. And then I think Bob Motzko was like, it's not really playing a role. We got a guy that's getting burritos from like a Chipotle and that's it. It's like, yeah, you're Minnesota. Like, I think you got some NIL offers out there, I think. I think it plays a role with the bigger players, the high-end draft picks. I mean, like Matthew Wood is in the portal today from UConn, his first-round pick. I think he's probably going somewhere where there's going to be an NIL deal. You know, I think that's pretty much a guarantee. It all depends. I mean, I've heard some guys get as little as like a $5,000 or $10,000 NIL deal. Top end guys. I've heard some guys that have been in the $100,000 range. It doesn't approach football where you get, you know, your top end guys are in over a million, some of them. But yeah, I think there's been some bigger NHL prospects that I think have committed either out of the portal or just as freshmen, that the number that's kind of been bandied around with me was at or around $100,000 in NIL money.
So do you think, like, so how much is this playing into the fact that like, this is kind of a way around like the scholarship limit, right? Like if you have a guy that is the 19th best guy on your team, you can still get him on your team because you gave him 50 grand in NIL, right? Like,
yep.
It's basically, still getting his scholarship basically, right? Like,
And the thing now too is it wasn't supposed to be able to be used as part of the recruiting process. It was not supposed to be.
Yeah, it's supposed to be decided like after. Right?
After, but then there's actually an injunction against the NCAA right now where they can't enforce that. So I think it was the University of Tennessee. I believe it was the University of Tennessee, and there may have been,
because Tennessee was also the state that the injunction exists to prevent or to allow kids to go into the portal without a sit out year a second time, right? I think that's the same lawsuit.
So I believe so. And the argument in the lawsuit was, how can we not tell the student athletes about their NIL offerings until after they commit? That needs to be part of their recruiting process, so they know where they should commit to. Like, they should have all that information available to them. So now, and there was an injunction filed, and the NCAA has stopped enforcing it for now. You know, when the injunction was filed against unlimited transfers, they released a press release an hour and a half later and said, "We're not enforcing our transfer rules anymore." it took them no time at all. It was like, I remember that the ruling happened at like 10 a.m. on a Friday, and at 11:30, I had a press release in my inbox that the NCAA was no longer enforcing transfer rules. So I think it's going to be kind of the same thing. Like, as far as I know, it can be part of your recruiting process now because there's an injunction, and it is. The school that you would expect have NIL money to offer are the ones that I think are offering it, you know, and everyone, others might be at the smaller level, but at least on like the major level, it's your Big Ten schools and kind of your other power schools.
I know, because I know Michigan Tech has some, and we can all joke about this now, but I still have to mail Blake Pieta his $20 check, and I just got his address today, so that'll be in the mail soon.
I think most schools have something now, interesting.
What that came from, and you probably haven't heard this, is we used to do jersey sales all the time, like authentic jersey orders,
mm-hmm.
and somebody canceled their order. So somebody backfilled that order, but wanted their jersey to be number 31 and say B. Pietola on it. And I was like, wait a minute, I can actually ask the school if that's okay now.
Yeah.
Because NIL exists. So now I can go say, hey, can we sign this player to an NIL deal? And every jersey we sell, that we give them $20. And the school was like, yeah, sure, go. But you have to deal with Blake directly. Is okay, but we can't be the intermediary, and that's fine. So I contacted him, and then he talked to compliance and worked it all out. And now I finally, with my ADHD, I'm remembering that I still have to mail him a check. And so I've got an address to send it. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I think other schools should be smart to do that. Like, I saw one the other day. With putting guys into the portal spreadsheet I have, I've been going to so many schools' websites, I don't remember which one it was. I want to say it was Providence. I think it was Providence's website, where right on their roster page, like, you could go in and, hey, if you want to hire like this guy to come to your kid's birthday party, you can.
Yeah, it was basically like a built-in cameo, right?
Yeah. Yep. Like, which, you know what? Like, if my kid was a big Providence, like if I was a Providence hockey alum and we went to all the Providence hockey games and my kid was a fan and I could, you know, hire, I don't know, like whoever, you know, I could hire Phillips Feedback to come to his birthday party and that's his favorite player and it's going to cost me $300. I'd probably do it. Every school should be smart to do that. And everything else, like, you could, some of them had, like, you know, signed pucks, like, and who knows how many of them are actually being sold. But I think it said, like, on the merchandise standpoint, the player, because again, it can't go through the school. So, like, if you wanted a signed puck from a player, the player goes to the school, buys the puck from the school, signs it, and then sells it to you for whatever the rate was. That was kind of like the official way that it happened. But I think it's every school can do that. Smart.
We as Tech Hockey Guide could be setting up a web store that's got jerseys for everybody, and the mm-hmm. player gets $10 of every shirt, and they cost, you know, $8 more than they normally would because it's going to the player. And we could do stuff like that, and we should probably look into that stuff. But like that's an option that all these teams should be looking at. And I think Wisconsin did something like that too, where they had like the cameo link where you could go hire them to send you a thank you or wish you a happy birthday or have you come to your event. I know we joked at one point about like hiring Carson Vantel to come to a Tech Hockey Guide event in Houghton when Wisconsin was in town or something because he had played at Tech and whatnot. But yeah, there's definitely avenues that I think there's unique directions that the smaller schools can go to try and compete in that way without it directly, you know, affecting things.
Do you work in manufacturing, product design, or product development? Is your business trying to improve efficiency while also producing at scale? Livonia Technical Services can help. They provide world-class quality improvement training and consulting for failure modes and effect analysis, product development, and cost reduction. all things that could help Northern Michigan assemble a competent defense. If you think your business could use a prevention mindset and reduce manufacturing costs, a partnership with Livonia Technical Services might be right for you. Check them out at livoniatech.net. That's LIVONIA tech.net.
Fibke Dental is a general dentistry practice located in downtown Rhinelander, Wisconsin, home of the Hodag. Look online at FibkeDental.com or find them on Facebook. They do pain-free dentistry for kids, adults, people that went to great schools, and people that ended up at Northern Michigan. Stop in and say hi between 8 and 5 and tell them THG sent you. That is FibkeDental.com.
It's 1969. Not
yeah, I think it's okay. The year
69. Okay.
This isn't 420XXX on his username.
Yeah, he doesn't have like a Mountain Dew and Doritos profile picture on. Yeah, on Discord.
I think this
something.
More this may be an ignorant boomer rather than nice.
Okay, gotcha. He's not just like
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the CCHA with your host, Tim Brown, Rob Gilreath, Dustin Lindstrom, and Matt Cavender.
Welcome to episode 53 of season 5 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, presented by Tech Hockey Guide and recorded from the state of hockey. I'm Tim Brown, your host, and I'm joined this week by Rob Gilreath.
Hey, guys.
And Matt Cavender.
You already know who it is.
I might as well do this right on the podcast. We're throwing Dustin under the bus because we're switching from Slack to Discord and he refuses to join us. So he was not aware that we are recording tonight. So that's where he is. I don't even know if he listens to this, so he might never hear this. So with Michigan Tech season over now and the Providence Regional behind us, we reached out to Mike McMahon, who covered the regional for College Hockey News and runs a Substack called College Hockey Insider. Thanks for joining us, Mike.
Yeah, thanks for having me back.
Yeah. This week we'll talk about Michigan Tech, BC, the Providence Regional, the NCAA Tournament. I'm sure we'll talk about the Misfits fundraiser and their lovely trek to Providence and back. And then we'll talk about the transfer portal. And I guess maybe we should have that Stonehill conversation on the podcast since Matt's so enamored with Stonehill. So
fascinated by them.
Anything else you guys want to talk about?
Nope. That sounds good.
Now let's put a bow on the season.
All right. We'll be right back with Mike McMahon after a little thank you notes and a brief note from our sponsor.